one expected me to compose music. I just did. What I have done is what was in me. The combination of New York, where I was born, and the rising, exhilarating rhythm of it, with centuries of hereditary feeling back of me. They ask me what I'm trying to do, and I can only say that I'm trying to express what is in me. Some people have the ability to put their feelings into words or music. There are thousands who have the same feeling and are mute. Those of us who can must speak for those who cannot, and we must be honest about it.
When Gershwin wrote those words, he summed up his entire art, the art of communication, of putting into music the thoughts and emotions of his listeners. Gershwin was in touch with his listeners in a way few composers can match, and his abiding popularity is the proof of this. For most people, there are two George Gershwins. There's Gershwin, the composer of immortal songs, known throughout the world. Our Love Is Here to Stay, Someone to Watch Over Me, I Got Rhythm. And then there's the concert hall Gershwin, composer of Rhapsody in Blue, An American in Paris, and the epic opera Porgy and Bess, all now in the repertoire of the world's greatest symphony orchestras and opera houses. But in this program, I want to show how the songs and concert works were all part of the same man, and evolved together. For Gershwin, there were no divisions or contradictions. For him, a 16-bar song was as important as a 3-movement symphony, and he had no time for musical labels or categorizations.
Jazz is a word which has been used for at least 5 or 6 types of music. It is really a conglomeration of many things. It has a little bit of ragtime, the blues, classicism, and spirituals. The same word trouble surrounds the colloquial use of the phrase classical music. It means as many things as there are people to say it. A man writes a piece of music which he considers serious, but which is pretty awful. He labels his work classic, and an unsuspecting public accepts the label. From any sound critical standpoint, labels mean nothing at all. Good music is good music, even if you call it oysters.
So how did it all begin for Gershwin? Well, not auspiciously, that's for sure. There was no piano in the Gershwin household before George was 12 years old. Yet while still a teenager, Gershwin was already making a living in the world of music. He didn't have time to go to music college. Within the lack of music conservatory training, Gershwin was no different from countless composers before him, including Elgar, Bach, Mozart, to name just 3. In fact, it was probably a positive advantage, as Gershwin's learning came by necessity from direct experience, as well as from his own intense self-drive and thirst for knowledge that he always seems to have had. This constant learning process kept his music continually on the move, continually evolving. What about his working methods? How did Gershwin structure his day? Well, we have the composer's own words to enlighten us there.
My work is done almost exclusively at night, and my best is achieved in the fall and winter months. A beautiful spring or summer day is least conducive to making music, for I prefer the outdoors to the work. I don't write at all in the morning, for the obvious reason that I'm not awake at the time. The afternoon, I devote to physical labor, orchestrations, piano copies, etc. At night, when other people are asleep or out for a good time, I can get absolute quiet for my composing. Not that perfect peace is always necessary. Often I've written my tunes with people in the same room or playing cards in the next. If I find myself in the desired mood, I can hold it until I finish the song.
If we take a bird's eye view of Gershwin's music, it's quite possible to see 3 distinct divisions. Let's, for the sake of argument, call them early, middle, and late. In the early period, we have songs like Swanee, Fascinating Rhythm, and the concert work Rhapsody in Blue. The middle period I would describe as covering the years 1925 to 1930, when Gershwin was at the height of his success on Broadway, and when his increasing career success was matched by a growing expressiveness in his music, as he became what he himself described as a modern romantic. Then comes the late period, covering roughly the last 6 years of his tragically short life, when his music became more personal than ever, and we reach what I'd call the real Gershwin. Back in 1920, it was Al Jolson's hit recording of Swanee that first brought Gershwin's name before a wider audience.
Swanee, how I love you, how I love you, my dear old Swanee. I'd give the world to be among the folk in a T.I.X.I. even though my man is waiting for me, praying for me down by the Swanee. The folks up north will see me no more when I go to that Swanee shore. Swanee, Swanee, I am coming back to Swanee. Mammy, I love the old folks at
Some of Gershwin's musical hallmarks can be heard in the Rhapsody's opening bars, especially his bold and unusual harmony. If you're not used to listening for harmony, or maybe the Rhapsody's opening is just too familiar to hear it objectively, let me help by illustrating it at the piano. If I play up the harmonies and play down the melody, you'll hear how chromatic Gershwin's harmony is, creeping from chord to chord. That blue note at the end is a typical Gershwin feature, of course. Blue notes are simply notes that have been flattened or lowered for effect, the notes that might be expected to coincide with the harmony are flattened to the next note down when played on the piano. Gershwin keeps the harmony of the unflattened note to clash deliberately with the blue notes, hence that irresistible feeling of tension. Harmony plays a vital part in Gershwin's music. In fact, I would say it's even more important than melody. It's the structure that holds up and enhances those beautiful melodies. Gershwin relates his discovery of the importance of harmony while under the guidance of local piano teacher Charles Hambitzer during his early teens.
He made me harmony conscious. Harmony, up to this time, had been a secret to me. I've always had a sort of instinctive feeling for tone combinations, and many chords that sound so modern in my orchestral compositions were set down without any particular attention to their theoretical structure.
Gershwin's harmony became very complex later in his career, but even in his earlier work, you can hear his fascination with its effect. For example, Gershwin loved repeating a melodic phrase, but with a different harmonic structure under the repeat to bring the melody alive. Here's just the melody of But Not For Me. But hear how it's transformed by changes in the harmony underneath. Again, the same device transforms the melody of the song Do It Again. Here's just the melody. And now the same melody, but this time with the harmony. Another of Gershwin's major hallmarks, not surprisingly, is rhythm, and he certainly made plenty of use of that. Here's an early example, written the same year as Rhapsody in Blue, and sung on this recording by the original cast. The song, fascinating rhythm. The cast, Fred and Adele Astaire, with George Gershwin on piano. It's a shame to stop George in full flight. When the singing stops, he can't wait to get on with his improvised break, just like being let off the leash. But let's hear that famous, fascinating rhythm again. Here's the melody, but with no rhythmical accents, so you can clearly hear how the same six-note figure is repeated three times. Now put it with the accompanying chords, which also supply the music's pulse, and you get this delightfully out-of-sync effect. The simple rhythmical device of one rhythm being out of phase with another was used a lot in Gershwin's early work. Here's the melody of the song Naughty Baby, devoid of the music's background pulse. Now I'll supply the pulse with the accompanying chords, and you'll hear the syncopation. Perhaps even more ambitious than some of Gershwin's early songs were the remarkable piano improvisations Gershwin would create spontaneously at New York parties, and which made his piano playing legendary. Gershwin had a natural talent for improvising, and thanks to the few electric recordings he made, one can hear these improvisations today. Listening carefully to them, they reveal very much a serious and imaginative mind at work, the mind of the composer George Gershwin, experimenting with his songs with a view to their potential development as musical ideas. Let's take a closer look at one of his improvisations on the song Sweet and Lowdown. First, here's the simple published song version. Gershwin's wonderful improvisation on the song, recorded in 1926, he fills out the opening melody with some wonderfully bluesy harmony. And just as he reaches that high note, the pause on it gives Gershwin the perfect excuse to introduce some marvelous syncopations. Let me play you the hands separately so you can hear what's happening. The right hand is playing the rhythm emphatically straight, while the left hand's rhythm is all haywire. So So together we get the syncopation. In the next chorus, Gershwin again introduces a complicated syncopation when he reaches the same point. If I play just the left hand of the syncopation, you'll hear how the pattern is grouped into threes. But the music's pulse is in twos. If I tap out the pulse on a single note in the right hand, you'll be able to hear the syncopation that the left hand pattern creates. Against this left hand, the right hand complicates matters by inserting trills on some of the left hand's offbeats. And remember, all this complication remains firmly inside Gershwin's head, as none of these improvisations were written down by him. When I first heard Gershwin's own recording of Sweet and Lowdown, it was the first time I'd ever heard Gershwin's piano playing, and I was bowled over by it. If you're not familiar with this style of playing, probably the first thing that will grab your attention is the rhythmic drive. This is partly encouraged by Gershwin's use of a stride bass, the left hand's insistent leaping. If I slow it down, you'll see that each bar begins with a large chord, usually a tenth with extra notes in between. The left hand then moves up to the middle of the keyboard to play a short, crunchy chord, then down to a low bass note, then back up to the middle of the keyboard. All this is played at great speed just by the left hand. Above this, the right hand plays the melody, usually in thick chords and octaves. The combination of a leaping bass and thick chords above gives the music a thick orchestral type texture and also makes it very difficult to play. Anyway, let's hear Gershwin's original 1926 recording of Sweet and Lowdown. Gershwin himself, improvising on his song Sweet and Lowdown, recorded in 1926. Then he was at the height of his fame, on Broadway and in the concert hall. We've now moved on to what I'd call Gershwin's middle period, which spans the second half of the 1920s, taking in the Concerto in F of 1925, An American in Paris, premiered in 1928, and such shows as OK, Funny Face, and Girl Crazy. The youthful exuberance of Gershwin's early period is still there, but it's been enhanced by a more overtly romantic tone. The melodies now have long sweeping arcs, and they seem to speak even more directly to their listener. It's hard to believe songwriting could have caused someone with Gershwin's abilities any trouble, but here's Gershwin's own view.
People think all a number needs for success, it seems, is 32 bars. A good phrase of 8 bars used to start the refrain is repeated twice more, with a new 8-bar added, which is much less important. Sounds simple, of course, but personally, I can think of no more nerve-wracking, no more mentally arduous task than making music. There are times when a phrase of music will cost many hours of internal sweating. Rhythms romp through one's brain, but they're not easy to capture and keep. As to inspiration, when we most want it, it does not come. Therefore, the composer does not sit around and wait for an inspiration to walk up and introduce itself. What he substitutes for it is nothing more than talent plus his knowledge. if his endowment is great enough, the song is made to sound as if it were truly inspired.
Gertrude Lawrence, singing the song Gershwin wrote for her, Someone to Watch Over Me, recorded in 1926. The warmth of feeling and the broad melodic sweep are typical of Gershwin's middle period, as is the touching, almost innocent sentiment of the song. The harmonies aren't as adventurous as those of his concert works of the same period, but this is hardly surprising, given the greater scope Gershwin had in a concert work to express himself. Later in his career, he'd incorporate some of the innovations of his concert works into his songs, as the two became more interrelated in style and form. Talking of form brings me to Gershwin's first large-scale work of this middle period, his Piano Concerto in F. It was commissioned by the conductor Walter Damrosch in 1925, following the spectacular success of Rhapsody in Blue. Needless to say, the Concerto in F abounds with beautiful melodies and rich harmonies, but it also brings to the fore Gershwin's mastery of form and structure. The structure, or overall shape of a work, is as much about pacing as anything, and in this, Gershwin's skill must surely have been fine-tuned by his experiences in the musical theatre, where the pacing of a show made all the difference between success and failure. Knowing how to keep the listener's attention, knowing when to change mood or direction, or for how long to sustain a particular mood or idea, are highly skilled abilities that not all composers possess. It's no good having good ideas if you don't know how to use them to their best advantage. On the other hand, of course, all the compositional skill in the world will never make up for a lack of ideas. There's no question what Gershwin himself considered most important in music.
Ideas and feeling. The various tonalities and sounds mean nothing unless they grow out of ideas. Not many composers have ideas. Far more of them know how to use strange instruments which do not require ideas. Whoever has inspired ideas will write the great music of our period.
The slow movement of the Concerto in F is a wonderful example of the intelligent use of inspired ideas. In particular, the timing or pacing of the movement is perfectly judged. Here's one example in which Gershwin sets up to perfection the entry of the slow movement's sublime second theme, is a beautifully poised piano cadenza. The theme has already been hinted at earlier in the movement, and at the beginning of this extract, you'll hear how Gershwin prepares the way for the theme's entry by further hints in the solo piano, so that by the time the orchestra takes up the theme in its entirety, the listener already feels familiar with it. On this rare recording, Gershwin himself is playing the solo part in a live radio broadcast made in 1935.
Thank you.
Gershwin himself performing part of his concerto in F. The most innovative piece of Gershwin's middle period is undoubtedly the tone poem An American in Paris, written and premiered in 1928. Composed in the cities of both Paris and New York, the score includes the use of authentic French taxi horns. More importantly, the most striking feature of this work is the use of much shorter ideas and musical motifs compared with the broad, sweeping melodies of Concerto in F. Here's the opening in the original recording conducted by Nathaniel Silkret. Gershwin this time is somewhere towards the back of the orchestra, playing the fairly unglamorous Celeste part. Shorter ideas in An American in Paris are ideal for development and musical manipulation, and Gershwin's development of ideas is much more extensive than in previous works. Here's a typical Gershwin touch, a few bars into the work. You have this bass figure. And above it, the same figure is played twice as fast, which produces this delightful contrapuntal effect, plus the harmony. Do you see, too, how Gershwin is building up the music in a series of layers, one on top of another? This contrapuntal way of thinking was natural to Gershwin and becomes increasingly important in his later works. But I can only scratch the surface in these examples because almost every bar of the score contains clever musical devices of one sort or another. An American in Paris isn't, for all this use of motifs, without its typical broad Gershwin melody. Here it is, again from the original 1929 recording. Even this superb melody is developed by Gershwin by splitting it up into individual components or motifs. For example, the rhythmical shape of the melody, a long-held note, followed by regular beats, is developed like this, for instance. Rhythm of the accompanying idea in that passage is itself a development of an idea that appears when the big tune is first heard. Two ideas, the big tune and its accompanying figure, are developed side by side in a superb example of contrapuntal development. Here's a longer extract in which you can hear Gershwin breaking up all the ideas into smaller motifs. Again, this is taken from the original 1929 recording. Thank you. That beautifully sinewy idea at the end is filled very much with the darker feeling of Gershwin's later works, which I'll discuss in a moment. But it twists around on itself in an out-of-sync effect with the background harmony and pulse, just as the melody of Fascinating Rhythm did many moons ago. Gershwin was very clear-headed in his approach to composing, and it shows not only in the logical train of his thought, but also in his constant quest for new ways of constructing his music. He was very articulate in his views on music, and his thoughts on the subject of composing are typically matter-of-fact and forthright.
Making music is actually little else than a matter of invention, aided and abetted by emotion. In composing, we combine what we know of music and what we feel. To my mind, all artists are a combination of two elements, the heart and the brain. Some composers overdo one of the elements in their work. Tchaikovsky, although he was a good technician, was apt to stress the heart too much. Berlioz was all mind. Now, Bach was that glorious example of the unity of the two. To me, feeling counts more than anything else, more than technique or knowledge. Of course, feeling by itself, without certain other attributes, is not enough. But it is the supreme essential.
At the end of his middle period, as I've called it, Gershwin wrote a song that seems to have become almost a signature tune for him. Well, who doesn't know I Got Rhythm, written for the 1929 show Girl Crazy? This song, like the ideas in An American in Paris, is built up out of shorter motifs. Here's Gershwin himself, improvising on it in a live concert recording made in 1931. What incredible playing by George Gershwin. And notice how the superbly syncopated rhythm of the theme. Is kept as a motif throughout the song. How carefully, though, were you listening to Gershwin's performance? Did you hear those complicated chords at the opening? They fall neatly into a two-bar intro, 8 beats in total, but just try and count 8 against their complicated syncopation. I'll help by counting you in with 4 beats. 2, 3, 4. Like a lot of good music that may sound haphazard and spontaneous, there is often a good deal of intelligence and thought behind it. Did you also notice during Gershwin's performance that little interjection halfway through the first chorus, like this? If you examine those harmonies a bit more closely, you might see where they come from. That's Debussy's piano prelude, The West Wind. Here's Debussy's harmonies again. And Gershwin's. De- Debussy was one of Gershwin's great idols, and his music had a profound effect on Gershwin, in fact, influencing him more than the music of any of his own contemporaries. It's fascinating to see how Gershwin then went on to influence Ravel in his piano concertos, a perfect cross-fertilization system in process, but that's another story. Let's go back and have a closer look at that snappy rhythmic motif that makes up I Got Rhythm. What gives it its swing is the syncopation caused by the length of the first three notes. All three are of an identical length. If I split up the tune into smaller subdivisions, you can hear for yourselves. Play that against the accompanying pulse, and you'll see where the subdivisions do and don't coincide with the beat. Hence the syncopation. Take out the smaller subdivisions again. Now remove the left-hand pulse altogether, and we're left with... I Got Rhythm was one of Gershwin's favourite show tunes. He was always improvising on it. In a moment, I'll play an extract from another of his improvised performances. But first, let me pull it apart so you can see what's going on. To begin with, he takes the theme with his right-hand thumb. And since he still has four fingers on his right hand with nothing to do, he gives them a counter-melody to play. The left hand then supplies the beats. Only to make it a bit more interesting, those left hand notes are then placed off the beat rather than on, like this. Confused? Let Gershwin sort it all out for you. Here he is in a 1934 radio broadcast recording. And there he goes, into another variation. Not surprisingly, all these ideas eventually evolved into a concert work, Variations on I Got Rhythm, which falls well within Gershwin's later period. In the 1930s, it seems almost as though Gershwin sensed that his time was running out. The emphasis of his work began almost imperceptibly to change. His musical comedy scores became more stringent, his concert works more complex and uncompromising, and above all, his music became even more personal and strongly flavoured than ever. I don't think that he was out of focus at any time, said his close friend Kay Swift, and perhaps this was never more so than in the last 6 years of his life. To describe Gershwin's later style in a nutshell, everything increased in intensity. His rhythms and harmony became even more complex, his use of counterpoint even more pronounced, and his musical ideas seem to have lost some of their earlier innocence and now have a more taut, sinewy quality that can only be described as powerfully bittersweet. In a press interview, Gershwin once said,
I'd like my music to keep people, all kinds of people, awake when they should be sleeping. I'd like my compositions to be so vital that I'd be required by law to dispense sedatives with each score sold.
Well, as one who has been kept awake by many a Gershwin tune pounding through my head, I can vouch for his success there. Gershwin's late period, from 1930 to his tragically early death in 1937, includes three major concert works, Second Rhapsody, Cuban Overture, and the Variations on I Got Rhythm, as well as the acerbic political operettas of Thee I Sing and Let Him Eat Cake. We are a long way removed, both in style and content, from the days of Swanee and Fascinating Rhythm. And sadly for Gershwin, there is a wealth of music from his last years that is yet to receive its due. To my mind, one of Gershwin's most successful orchestral works is Cuban Overture. With its dark passion and breathtaking mastery of form and counterpoint, it's a natural precursor of Gershwin's great masterpiece, the opera Porgy and Bess. Porgy and Bess is beyond doubt not only the key work of Gershwin's late period, but of his whole life. It's no exaggeration to describe it as an epic, and it represents a culmination of all facets of Gershwin's multifaceted genius. In a sense, it's a perfect blend of his two worlds, the theatre and the concert hall. And with his experience of both, no one was in a better position to produce the perfect opera, which is exactly what Gershwin did. It must be emphasized that Porgy and Bess is not a Broadway show. Over the years, it has been cut and mauled in theatre and on celluloid, but the original remains an incredible masterpiece, a profoundly moving and very human story, deeply and sincerely expressed in Gershwin's sublime music. The opera is based on DuBose Heyward's novel Porgy, which itself is based on a poor black community in Charleston, South Carolina. And to prepare himself for the work, Gershwin steeped himself in the music of black communities in the American South, music which had already had a profound influence on his earlier work. Here's Gershwin on how the whole project came into being.
No story could have been more ideal for the serious form I needed than Porgy and Bess. I felt, when I read Porgy in novel form, that it had 100% dramatic intensity in addition to humor. It was then that I wrote to DuBose Heyward, suggesting that we make an opera of it. Mr. Heyward and I, in our collaboration on Porgy and Bess, have attempted to heighten the emotional values of the story without losing any of its original quality. I have written my music to be an integral part of that story. It is true that I have written songs for Porgy and Bess. I'm not ashamed of writing songs at any time, so long as they are good songs. In Porgy and Bess, I realized I was writing an opera for the theater, and without songs, it could be neither of the theater nor entertaining, from my viewpoint. But songs are entirely within the operatic tradition. Many of the most successful operas of the past have had songs. Nearly all of Verdi's operas contain what are known as song hits. Carmen is almost a collection of song hits.
Porgy and Bess is a subject of study in itself, but we can at least look at some of the musical hallmarks of Gershwin's later style, as manifested in the opera. Gershwin's fascination with complex harmony reaches new heights here. In this example, which I'll play from near the beginning of the opera, you can hear how he adds more and more harmony in a series of precisely calculated intervals, building up a huge wall of sound. Gershwin's love of complex rhythms has many manifestations in Porgy and Bess. In this next example, from the Kittiwa Island scene, the rhythm is built out of small units to create an exciting pulse. I could play that rhythm all night, it's so exciting. In Porgy and Bess, there are many musical motifs, melodic, harmonic, and rhythmic, which tie the whole opera together. The motifs depict both characters and situations. For example, here is the motif for the main character, Porgy. And here's the motif for Catfish Row, the tenement block where the opera is set, which first appears over these extraordinary harmonies. Notice the angularity of Gershwin's idea, with its often dissonant intervals within the melodic shape, a far cry from the simpler shapes of some of his earlier songs. The motif that depicts the aggressive character Crown is filled with ominous tension and energy. The first appearance of Crown and his accompanying motif are heralded by the following extraordinary passage. Porgy and Bess has a tight contrapuntal thread running throughout, with many different musical strands and motifs interwoven with each other. For example, the musical subject of a fugue that depicts two terrible murder scenes is cleverly made up of three highly significant motifs. First, a motif that accompanies a crap game early in the opera. Then the unsettling figuration that accompanies the appearance of a buzzard, an ill omen. And finally, Crown's motif. These motifs are built into one marvellous unit like this. Let's hear how Gershwin then develops a terrifyingly ominous fugue on this subject, played on this recent recording by the St. Louis Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Leonard Slatkin. In addition to Gershwin's clever contrapuntal use of themes and motifs, the opera is also held together emotionally by great chorus scenes. These choruses depict the drama of the moment in the manner of a Greek tragedy, as in this deeply moving Requiem scene, sung on this recording by the original cast, handpicked by Gershwin himself. Despite the cleverness of the construction of Porgy and Bess, to say nothing of the superb overall pacing of the work, Gershwin's great achievement in this opera is his portrayal of the characters and the depth of his understanding of their emotions. Even the villainous Crown is far from being depicted as a mindless thug. The opera as a whole, in a perfect performance, is a totally overwhelming experience because the emotions expressed are so real and genuine, so completely lacking in any phony front. At the centre of Porgy and Bess is a simple scene which seems to sum up the entire opera. A woman selling strawberries in the street sings over a poised harmony. Here it is on the piano. When this apparently simple idea is repeated, one note and one note only is changed in the harmony, totally altering the feel of the music, adding a terrible sense of tragedy and foreboding. If this isn't an illustration of the power of harmony, I don't know what is. Add to this the incredible singing of the original cast Strawberry Woman, again hand-picked by Gershwin himself, who sings with a depth of emotion that can only come from a history of sorrow and suffering, and you have the essence of Porgy and Bess. After Porgy and Bess, Gershwin was invited to Hollywood to write film scores for the irrepressible duo of Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers. Just as in Porgy and Bess, Gershwin had reached a peak in his large-scale works, so in Hollywood he reached his peak as a writer of immortal songs. Not surprisingly, the influence of Porgy and Bess is very evident in his Hollywood material, and far from the misconception that Gershwin's songs influenced his concert works, here we can see the exact opposite happening. The song Slap That Bass, and its treatment in the film in which it appears, Shall We Dance, could only have come from the pen of a man steeped in the black musical culture of the American South.
Zoom, 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 zoom. The world is in a mess.
Yes.
Politics and taxes and people grinding axes. There's no happiness. Zoom, 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 zoom. Rhythm, lead your ail. The future doesn't fret me. If I can only get me someone to snap that bass. Happiness is not a riddle when I'm listening to that big bass fiddle.
Zoom, 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 zoom.
Slap that bass, slap the pedal dizzy, slap that bass, keep the rhythm busy. Zoom, 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 misery, you got to go.
Misery, you got to go.
Slap that bass, use it like tonic, slap that bass, keep your philharmonic. Zoom, 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 and the milk and honey, oh.
Slap That Bass, from the original soundtrack of the film Shall We Dance. Much of the harmonies of this song and many of the other songs in Shall We Dance come straight out of Porgy and Bess. In the film's title song, Gershwin's rhythmical and harmonic complexities know no bounds. The constant offbeats of this number are a natural evolution of the rhythmic motifs in I Got Rhythm. Here's Fred Astaire on the film soundtrack in his superb rendition of Shall We Dance.
Drop that long bass, come on, have your fling. Why keep nursing the blues? If you want this old world on a string, put on your dancing shoes, stop wasting time. Put on your dancing shoes, watch your spirits climb. Shall we dance? Or keep on moping, shall we dance and walk on air? Shall we give in to despair? Or shall we dance with never a care? Life is short, we're growing older, don't you feel? And also
the complexity of Gershwin's musical devices in these last Hollywood songs of his in no way puts up barriers to the music's accessibility. Indeed, far from it, it actually helps to keep the listener listening. It's not only a testament to Gershwin's extraordinary powers of communication, but is also in direct contradiction to the fallacy that the general public prefers only simple themes, rhythms, and harmonies to listen to. In reality, as Gershwin himself said,
I'm one of those who honestly believe that the majority has much better taste and understanding, not only of music, but of any of the arts, than it is credited with having. It is not the few knowing ones whose opinions make any work of art great. It is the judgment of the great mass that finally decides.
With Porgy and Bess and Hollywood, Gershwin was at the height of his powers and was full of plans for more concert works, including a symphony and another opera. He had a string quartet already complete inside his head, but which he hadn't written down because the ideas were so vivid they remained firmly in his musical memory. Alas, all Gershwin's plans for the future came to nothing. Early in 1937, he began to suffer severe headaches and dizzy spells, and his normally robust health began to deteriorate with alarming rapidity. He had lapsed into a coma in July 1937, and an emergency operation disclosed a brain tumour. George Gershwin died the morning after the operation, on Sunday, July 11, 1937, at the tragically early age of 38. Only a few months earlier, he had written to his close friend from childhood, Mabel Shermer.
Dear Mabel, I am welcoming 1937. How about you? Perhaps, dear Mabel, this is our year. A year that will see both of us finding that elusive something that seems to bring happiness to the lucky. The pendulum swings back, so I've heard, and it's about due to swing us back to a more satisfying state. So, sweet Mabel, lift your glass high with me and drink a toast to two nice people who will, in a happy state, go places this year.